Well, good morning, church. My name is Justin Waples, pastor of Outreach and Discipleship here at East White Oak. We're so glad that each of you are here with us this morning as we're seeking to be worshipers maturing in Christ. I want to welcome all of our guests, especially if you're here for the first time this morning. If you see anyone with a blue lanyard on, they are specifically here to help answer any questions that you might have. You'll notice in the foyer we have some large displays that say, "We're glad you're here." There you'll find copies of this week's prayer requests, as well as sermon notes for this morning's service. Please feel free to slip out, grab those at any time. There you'll also find a welcome booklet. Familiarize yourself with our church and the ministries here. This morning we're going to study a portion of the passage from Luke chapter 24, the story of the risen Jesus, when he meets with his disciples before he ascends to heaven. Jesus teaches us that day that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed. Consider these verses from Psalm chapter 19. Who can discern his error? Lord, declare in me innocent of hidden faults. Keep back your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then, O Lord, shall I be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Pray with me this morning as we head into a time of worship. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, prepare our hearts for worship of you this morning, our one and only Savior. Purge me with hyssop that I shall be clean. Wash me, I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, blot out all of my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. May this be our prayer this morning. It's through Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, Amen.
Good morning. We are glad to be with you this morning. Will you stand with us as we sing, "Rejoice in the Lord now and always"?
Delight in the love he has shown us, gratefully
That last song brings such joy to my heart. Let not conscience make you linger, nor of fitness fondly dream. All the fitness he requires is to feel your need of him. So come, ye weary, heavy laden, lost and ruined by the fall. If you tarry till you're better, you will never come at all. I will rise and go to Jesus. He'll embrace me in his arms. May that be our prayer today. Our summer children's ministry planning's in full swing. I want to invite up our children's ministry director, Beth Frommey, to share with you this morning.
Can you guess our theme for the summer? Are you a fan of superhero movies? Anybody? Love your superheroes? I brought my own superheroes. Good job, guys. This summer, our children in first through sixth grade will be learning all about superheroes, but not your normal mainstream superheroes. They are Bible superheroes. They're going to learn about some pretty cool people who did some pretty cool things from the Bible, and they were like superheroes, but it doesn't stop there. They're going to learn mostly how Jesus is our real superhero. And every summer we give our regular teachers a break, a much needed break in a time of refreshment where they can attend ABF classes in church. And that means we need a whole new crew of teachers and leaders for the summer. And I was wondering if you would consider spending part or all of your summer with us in children's ministry, having a blast learning about superheroes and be the superhero. The summer is divided into 2 7-week halves. You can serve one half, or if you're having so much fun that you don't want to quit, you can serve both halves from June 2nd to July 14th, and then July 21st to September 1st are the sessions. We need some key leaders. Shepherds stay with a small group of children by age. There's no teaching or prep required. You show up, you have fun with the kids, you get to know them, and just get to know your group, and that's a lot of fun. I also need a handful of activity leaders, and they are the ones who are going to lead and carry out the week's main activity, which could be a snack, a craft, an experiment, games, all kinds of stuff. The first week, we're making ice cream. How cool is that? So all you have to do is know what you're doing. It's all prepped for you. There's no prep work involved. It's all done for you. In addition to those leaders, I need a couple key people. One would be an AV and tech person who can run the computer, music, PowerPoint for our Bible lesson time. And a really special one this summer, if you can guess, like, by the way, we're dressed up here. I need some actual superheroes who are willing to dress up and be enthusiastic. If you like acting and drama, if you like making kids laugh and getting their attention, you might make a really good superhero for the summer. I need a couple of people to do that. And it is a huge commitment for the summer. Are you ready? 5 minutes. 5 minutes out of your morning to be the superhero is all it would take. If that's something you would enjoy, you can catch me in the hallway. I would just like to invite you to join us, prayerfully consider being part of our summer children's ministry. I have a table in the hallway. You can also go to the website here to sign up online. And just want to thank you for just considering. We have a blast. I promise you it's fun and energetic, and you won't be disappointed. And you get a chance to be the superhero and impact Boys and Girls for Christ this summer. And you will be blessed yourself for being part of it. Thank you.
Pray with me this morning. Lord Heavenly Father, enable us to serve our church and our children well this summer. May every role be filled, every child encouraged with the truth of your word. May we as fathers bring our children up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord, bringing them to church, seeking places to teach and to serve well. May our mothers have children who rise up and call them blessed, serving well with wisdom, with the teaching of kindness on their tongue. May each adult, young adult, teen that's helping to serve do so for the glory of God. For there's a place for every one of us to serve. Give us, Lord, abiding in Jesus, that we may bring forth more fruit, have a deeper sense of our obligations to him, that we may surrender all, have a fuller joy, and that we may serve him more completely. Lord, we pray now for the children and the youth in Burma. Our friend, Pastor Mingu in Burma, is participating today in the Burmese Water Festival in the new year, lasting from the 13th of April through the 17th. Lord, we would pray that they are having 2 days where they'll be conducting youth training. Lord, let us remember these leaders and youth in our prayers, that God will bless them and that God will bless the leaders and children here at East White Oak in the coming days. Lord, we thank you for this and we pray all of it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll invite Paul up now.
I would like to extend a special welcome to our guests who are here with us today. You are invited to begin a text conversation with us by texting EWOBC to 77411. Our welcome staff looks forward to meeting you and would be happy to answer any questions that you might have about our church. The Welcome Center is located out the back doors here and to the left. Here's an important reminder for parents of sixth graders. There is a youth ministry orientation meeting after the second service today in the senior high room. We will tell you all that you need to know about the transition from your son or daughter that they will be making from where they're at now and into the youth, East White Oak Youth Ministry. For a complete look at all things East White Oak, go to the church's website, eastwhiteoak.church, and click on the Oak Central button. Our weekly e-bulletin has event details and links to all the online registrations that you'll hear about. It comes to your email inbox on Thursdays. Sign up for the email bulletin by texting EWOBC to 77411. If you came prepared today to joyfully give, you may use the connection boxes that are located at the back of the worship center near the exits, or you can use the church's online giving platform and just click on the Give tab on the church's homepage. At this time, I'm going to invite you to stand with us as we continue singing in our time of worship and song this morning. This song we've introduced a couple different times. It's called I Set My Hope. And I feel like for me personally, there's different lyrics in each verse. And verse 3 has kind of stuck out to me lately and some of the things that I've been going through in life. Though the world call me to leave my Lord, I set my hope on Jesus. Though it offer all its vain rewards, I set my hope on Jesus. Though this heart of mine is prone to stray, give me grace enough to finish till I worship on that final day. I set my hope on Jesus. Join with us as we sing together.
My faith, I set my hope on Jesus.
Amen. If you open your Bibles to Luke chapter 24 this morning, bear with me. I'm losing my voice a little bit. Lord willing, we'll make it through. Luke chapter 24, repentance for the forgiveness of sins, verses 36 through 49. Our focus in our outline this morning will consist of studying the following verses here. The first eight verses, Jesus draws close to those that he loves. The next three verses, Jesus declares truth to those that he loves. And then our main verse for the text this morning, Jesus, in verse 47, delivers from sin those he loves. In the last two verses, Jesus directs the lives of those that he loves. We'll come back to those in a few minutes if you're trying to write them down. The big idea for today, Christ suffered and rose on the third day from the dead so that the gospel could be proclaimed. This means that no matter the trials we face in this world, we should preach the good news of repentance for the forgiveness of sins in his name to all the nations. Listen now to the words of the Lord this morning, Luke chapter 24, verse 46 and 47. Jesus said to his disciples, "Thus it is written, that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem." The day was Sunday, April 17th, 1870. Just shy of 154 years of today's date, Charles Haddon Spurgeon began preaching at the Metropolitan Tabernacle in historic London, England. And at the age of 36, he said this about verse 47 in Luke chapter 24. He says, "This verse is among our Lord's last words to his disciples just before he left them to return to heaven. He wishes to impress upon them the truth that it was his purpose and desire that their lives should be devoted to the preaching of his gospel among the nations upon the face of the earth." He says in Christ's own words and throughout the New Testament, we find the greatest stress laid upon preaching. Preaching is the great battering ram that is to shake the gates of hell. Preaching is God's chief method of winning souls unto himself. He cites 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21, "For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe." Spurgeon continued saying in a sermon from 1870, "We cannot too often remind this age in which we live of this truth. For this is a time which is supposed that rites and ceremonies, human learning and literature, these things will be allowed to supplant the preaching of the word." Yet our Lord has given no indication, he says, of any change in his purpose or plan. On the contrary, the Great Commission is evidently intended to cover the whole present dispensation, or this church age. He cites Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission, "Go therefore, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I have commanded of you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." A young 29-year-old hymn writer, her name Jane Taylor, she penned these words in 1812 to the hymn titled Repentance. She wrote, "Repentance is to leave the things we loved before, and to show an earnest grieve, grieve by doing so no more." You see, church, we cannot be forgiven by sin when we are in love with sin. For when we live in sin, we cannot find pardon from it. We must not seek forgiveness merely from the fear of punishment or hell, but seek repentance because God hates sin. Spurgeon continued on saying, "Repentance is not a grace to which is only to be exercised by us for a week or so at the beginning of our Christian life, but repentance is to attend with us all the way into heaven." Faith and repentance are to be inseparable companions throughout our pilgrimage to glory. Repenting of our sin, trusting in the great sin bearer, it is to be the tenor of our lives. And we are to preach it to others that it must be so. We are to preach a final and irreversible remission, not a pardon which is given and then taken back again, so that a man may have his sins forgiven, yet be punished for them over and over. He says, "I loathe a gospel like that." Do not be discouraged today, brother and sister, when we discuss repentance. For when one repents, we see God's work in their lives. It is a divine empowerment. God's resurrection power is alive and active at work. Pastor Scott preached right here over a decade ago about how repentance gives others joy. Repentance brings to others comfort and refreshes the soul. Repentance is not a list of do's and of don'ts. It is a call to see what God finds beautiful. This is the connection between repentance and the resurrection. Consider a few verses with me this morning. Acts chapter 17, "Being then God's offering, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he'll judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he's appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." The Lord commands everyone, everywhere, to repent. Why? Because there is a fixed day of judgment coming. And so the believer has assurance of salvation because of the raising of Jesus from the dead now. Dying to sin through repentance and a total surrender that we can gain eternal life. Consider Colossians chapter 3. Verse 5, "Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry." And verses 12 through 15, "Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving one another, as the Lord has forgiven you. And so you must also forgive. And above all of these things, we put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful." And so on that Sunday, 154 years ago, Spurgeon concludes his sermon on Luke chapter 24, saying, "Until this church age is brought to a close by the personal return of the Lord Jesus Christ, repentance for the forgiveness of sins is to be preached in his name to all the nations. Blessed indeed are those who in this land or anywhere else that have heard their Lord and Master say to them, as he said to his disciples before he left them, 'You are witnesses of these things.'" Please stand with me this morning for the reading of God's word. Luke chapter 24, verse 36 to 49. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they had saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And While they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Do you have anything to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it, he ate before them. He said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Verse 45, then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I'm sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." You may be seated. We'll see in these first verses that Jesus draws close to those he loves. Verse 36, it says, "As they were talking about these things, Jesus appears. What are these things that you ask?" Here we see the 11 disciples mentioned in verse 33 gathered together just a few verses back with the two travelers from the road of Emmaus. I preached on these previous 19 verses earlier in this year. At this point in Luke's gospel narrative, Jesus has been tried. He's been sentenced to death. He's been crucified. He's risen again. Do not let that fact slip you. Jesus has been crucified, buried, and risen back to life. He's risen indeed. And now here in Luke chapter 24, Jesus begins to draw close to those that he loves. What we learned in the middle passage of Luke chapter 24 was that the two on the road to Emmaus did not yet know and believe that Christ had risen. The two from the road to Emmaus end up having a divine encounter with the breathing, walking, living Lord Jesus Christ. The risen Jesus joined these two in their times of trial. When they were at their weakest, weary, and sad, Christ came unto them. The risen Jesus proclaimed his gospel message, asking, "Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer and suffer these things and enter into his glory?" But the eyes of those two were kept from recognizing him that day. The risen Jesus, who they did not recognize, then interpreted for them all the scriptures concerning the Messiah. He joined them at a table for a meal, took bread and blessed it and broke it, and then revealed himself as their Lord and Master. Then vanishing from their sight, the two get up right away and go to share the good news. "Christ, he is risen indeed," they would proclaim. So here, verses 33 to 35, we find the 11 disciples. We hear about the story of the eyewitness testimony of Simon's encounter with Jesus. And then the two from the road share their story. Note here that we have only the 11 disciples. For Judas betrayed Jesus. He then committed suicide. He's no longer with them. But this group is quoted and now called the 12. It's the running term for the disciples, but truly there only are 11 mentioned here in Luke. We hear about Simon's encounter. He was called Simon Peter, also referred to as Cephas in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 5. 1 Corinthians then went on to describe other eyewitnesses of the 500 people, including James, the half-brother of Jesus, all the apostles, to Paul. They all saw Jesus resurrected from the dead, the perfect Son, the sacrificed, now risen, offering repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Here we are at verse 36. "As they were talking about these things, all the things I just shared with you, Jesus stood among them and said, 'Peace to you.'" Excitement and curiosity must have ruled the conversation. Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace to you." Oh, how I'd love to hear my Savior say that words in Scripture. Jesus stood. He did not levitate like some mythic creature. He did not disguise himself. He did not run towards them as if he were charging the group coming for battle. He was greeting them with words of comfort. Verse 37, they were startled and frightened, thought they'd saw a spirit. The very thing that made their world seem so unrecognizable had returned. And they thought it was some disembodied spirit. They were startled and frightened due to their unbelief. It was so wonderful and unexpected that even though they were just talking about his appearances, Christ then appears right in front of them, just as he had disappeared in the previous encounter, clothed in this celestial body, not bound by the limitations of an ordinary human earthly body. He who was once crucified had now risen. And in the end, it was the disciples' unbelief that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory and return from the dead. I might suggest a sermon for you to listen to by Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. It's titled, The Nature of Unbelief. Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, The Nature of Unbelief, a wonderful message by a renowned pastor and theologian. It was their unbelief that Christ would rise again, conquering sin and conquering death. It was their unbelief that the God-man, the perfect, sinless sacrifice, the Lord Jesus Christ, one triune God, eternally existing in three persons, co-eternal in being, co-identical in nature, co-equal in power and in glory, having the same attributes and perfections prophesied from the beginning with Moses and all the prophets, the one in whom they must place their eternal trust, seeking forgiveness and the pardon of sins, to be indwelt with the Holy Spirit, to live forevermore with the King at the right hand of the Father, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." The very thing that had made their world seem so unrecognizable stood in front of them. Verse 38, he said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts?" Again, Jesus speaks and offers questioning words of comfort and of care. Jesus had called the two travelers on the road to Emmaus, "O foolish ones, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken." A similar charge now given to these disciples. Perhaps some of us face those same troubles today. Doubting hearts when we experience the risen Savior. Even simply in our text today, Jesus calls each of them to look upon him in a sober manner. "See my hands and my feet," verse 39, "that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." Jesus offers assurance. See, touch, understand. God offers us many assurances, does he not? Throughout Scripture, assurance of salvation, assurance of answered prayer, assurance of victory, assurance of forgiveness, assurance of guidance. He says, "It is I myself," testifying to himself. Jesus contrasts himself to a spirit, for he has real flesh and bones, affirming that they do see him, that he is real. He's not an ethereal spirit created by human imagination. So verse 40, when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Here Jesus, like he approached the two on the road to Emmaus, draws near and then shows them his hands and his feet. Jesus does not want it to be unclear. He is a God of mystery, but does not want to remain mysterious. He's a God of infinite power, but humbles himself to human form. He is a God of complete knowledge, but longs for others to understand. He's a God of judgment, but gives every opportunity for repentance. Verse 41, while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything to eat?" This is the same disbelieving for joy that Pastor Scott recently referenced in a message in 2 Timothy. And he put it very well in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. It says, "The saying is trustworthy," gives a few of them, one of them, "if we are faithless, he remains faithful." This disbelieving for joy or this faithlessness is one of two things. It's either a momentary lapse of faithfulness, or it's for those who have made a false profession and have never truly believed. both types referred to in the New Testament. Here these disciples have a momentary lapse of faith as they disbelieved for joy. Could it really be true? It seems too good to be true. And then in an instant, we see a maturing in their faith, a growing in Christ and the marveling of him before their eyes. Christ upholds the weak, but he brings a warning. The disciples, as well as in 2 Timothy chapter 2, we see those who have a momentary lapse of faith, and Christ upholds them in their weaknesses. Judas was never a real, genuine believer. He was faithless in that sense. And Judas caught all the condemnation of one who never repents. Your pastors and leaders here at East White Oak do not know if you are in some faithless state. We cannot judge if you are a Peter or a Judas. All we can say is run to Christ. Become a person who believes in the wonderful message of salvation. Through Jesus Christ alone, turn away from faithlessness, turn away from living for self, and turn to Christ. Jesus then asked for something to eat. Verse 42 and 3, they gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and ate it before them. He accepts. He eats in their presence. He shows them his humanity. Jesus offers some real world proof of his personhood by eating. Jesus rose from the dead just as was prophesied. And even in times of doubt and of worry, in your life, Jesus draws close to those that he loves. Did you know that God loves you this morning? No matter the situation that you're in, those who in their disbelief or no longer know or recognize their Savior, those who in times of trial don't see their risen Lord, those who may be in seasons of great joy but neglect to give God the glory and boast not in him alone. You might be familiar with Dane Ortlund's book, Gentle and Lowly, The Heart of Christ for Sinners and Sufferers. He opens up Matthew chapter 11, where Jesus described himself as gentle and lowly in heart, longing for his people to find rest in him. It helps us understand the gospel is primarily about God's heart drawn to his people, a heart tender, full of love for the sinful and suffering. Ortlund would take you in that book to depths of Christ's very heart for sinners, diving deep into scripture that speak of who Christ is, encouraging us with the affection that Christ has for his people. Jesus appears to his disciples, draws close to those that he loves, and he draws close to you today as well. The next three verses here, Jesus declares truth to those that he loves. Verse 44, then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Here he gives them the same argument that he gave to the two on the road to Emmaus. I encourage you to go back and listen to the message on that for further details on this same subject. He opens up the word. He teaches them all the scriptures have to say about the Messiah. He surely did not teach them only doctrine or prophecy. He taught them all the things concerning himself. This fulfilling of the scriptures that was written was happening there as they spoke. Christ says, verse 44, "These are my words that I spoke to you." And one day the fulfillment of his words will fully come when the Lord returns for a second time for the building of his final kingdom. Verse 45, he opens up their minds to understand the scriptures. God gives them the spiritual capacity to understand. It is in part the response to the personal exposition of scripture that Christ gives. They are enlightened by the word, and then what is given is insight and understanding into God's plan. There's a pastor, Reverend George Campbell Morgan. He was the pastor at the Westminster Chapel in London. He was the mentor to Martin Lloyd-Jones. before handing over his pastor at that church to him in 1939. Reverend George Morgan said this about this verse: Christ opened their minds, which, he says, freed them from all prejudice, freed them from all pride, taking what was blurred and out of focus and bringing the whole thing into sequence for them. Again, my sermon on this subject from Luke chapter 24, verse 31, provides you more details about this opening of the mind and of the eyes. Verse 46, Jesus says to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead." 2 weeks ago was Easter Sunday. And then last week we studied Proclaim the Gospel from 2 Timothy chapter 4. Scott read to us these verses, the first one and a half. Here, "I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by this and by his appearing for the kingdom, preach the word." The living Lord Jesus will not hide from you the truths of his word. He is calling men to preach and to teach the whole gospel. He's calling faithful women to teach and to train their sisters in Christ. He's calling faithful parents and grandparents to love and care for their children and grandchildren. He's calling faithful youth not to be despised of their age, but to set believers as an example in speech and in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. We sang of this gospel truth this morning. Jesus declares truth to those that he loves. And he declares that he loves each of you this morning. "Jesus, your mercy is all I boast. The goodness I claim, the grounds of my hope, wherever I lack, I still want, I need most. Jesus, your mercy is all that I boast. Praise the King who bore my sin, took my place when I stood condemned. Oh, how good you've always been to me. I will sing of your mercy." Jesus declares truth to those that he loves. Now to verse 47, Jesus delivers from sin those that he loves. Verse 47, "And that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem." I chose this message today in part to encourage you on the theology and doctrine here of conversion. That is the role of repentance and faith in salvation. It's clear from Scripture that repentance is a part of faith and salvation. We read that in Acts chapter 17 at the beginning of our message this morning. And I desire that you would understand that ever more clearly today. Repentance is often incorrectly viewed as the same thing as saving faith. Consider Acts chapter 20, verse 20 and 21. Paul teaches us, "I did not shrink back from declaring to you anything that was profitable, and teaching you in public from house to house, testifying to Jew and to Greek of repentance toward God, and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ." Both repentance and faith are critically important. However, repentance has a distinct role. Repentance means a turning toward an inward changing. It appears that it works in conjunction with faith, being the part of faith that acknowledges sin and need. Consider 1 Thessalonians 1:9. "For it was reported how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and the true God." Therefore, faith and repentance is two sides of the same coin. If one is present, the other must be also. Consider a few things that we ought to avoid. We should avoid the idea that excessive sorrow leads or equals repentance. We should avoid the idea that one can merely turn to God or turn to Jesus without understanding what sin, judgment, and their need is. Many people turn to Jesus or turn to God, but they do not know why. This is not true repentance and faith. It is not genuine saving faith. For example, you may see in your own heart, in your own life, a faith that may not be genuine when you have a lack of any Christian works. James chapter 2, verses 14 through 20 can be summarized by the two verses, "What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but has no works? And show me your faith apart from your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder." The scriptures exhort us to voluntarily trust in Christ. Yet the scriptures describe this causative agency or this work that God does in us. God is the one that does the work. It seems clear that men and women will to believe, but only when they are quickened by divine power. Jesus delivers from sin those that he loves. Continue with me in verse 47. There is a command here to proclaim this repentance and forgiveness of sin, a command to do it in Jesus' name, a command to proclaim it to all the nations, a command here to proclaim the repentance for the forgiveness of sins in Jerusalem first. Jerusalem was the local area of ministry that they were in, the disciples. According to the text, they are commanded to start there in their own towns. So, proclaim the gospel where you live. You in Downs and Leroy and Lexington and Secor. You in Stanford and El Paso and Gridley and Roanoke. You in Bloomington and Chenoa and Danvers and Carlock and Towanda. You in Shirley and Hayworth and Mackinac and Goodfield and Cropsey. Proclaim the gospel in your Jerusalem. I know I missed somebody this morning. Who did I miss this morning? Hudson. Oh, I had Hudson and Kappa here. I knew I'd miss a couple. Proclaim the gospel first in your Jerusalem. Proclaim the gospel in your town and county, then proclaim it in every county, in every city, in every state, in every country, in every continent. Proclaim it to the ends of the earth. Spurgeon said that our Lord told his disciples to begin to preach the gospel in Jerusalem because it was at Jerusalem that the facts which made up the gospel had occurred. It was there that Jesus had died, was buried, and rose again. There he ascended into heaven. All these things happened at Jerusalem or not far from it. Therefore, the witness bearing of the apostles must be upon the spot in which they lay, for if they had lied, they would have been found out. We must take great comfort in this, my dear friend. If you are newer to your personal relationship in Jesus, or if you clearly know your first love for Christ and dedicated your life to him, do not be ashamed to tell those that you know about the gospel. Let it not be one of us that says, "I did not tell my spouse, I did not tell my children, I did not tell my friends." Never be ashamed of Christ. Tell them, "You know who I was, but now I have a loving, personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ." Begin in Jerusalem, right where you are. Spurgeon accurately said this almost 154 years ago. "I do not say that you are to go up and down the street crying out that you have been converted, but on occasion, you must not hide your conviction of the repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Conceal not what the Lord has done for you, but hold it up as a candle, as a light to the world, beginning in your own house." Share the good news of Jesus with brothers and sisters and cousins and extended family. Share the good news of Jesus with your neighbors. Spurgeon said, "London is a horrible place for the Christian to live." In 1870 here, he said, "Worldly vices and foul language abound." He compared London to the land of Sodom and Gomorrah. "What are we to do then?" "Well," he said, bear your witness, seeking to be worshipers, maturing in Christ. But what does repentance for the forgiveness of sins really mean? Repentance is a gift from God. Christ at the right hand of the Father gives repentance and forgiveness of sin where there's real sorrow, a desire to cease from sin. There's a complete change of the mind, a turning from sin. In Greek, a change of mind. In Hebrew, a change of action. Both are involved. A moral battle of ill will, but not guilt alone. A reformation of the heart. A reversal in one's thoughts and actions. What does it mean to proclaim repentance for the forgiveness of sins? Falling down before God, saying, Lord, save me, forgive me, be merciful to me, and then go tell the world. Were we to do it, we're to do it amongst our, and learn from our pathways of discipleship. Those around us that care for us and want to grow in Christ with us. For we're often returning to the sin which we once asked for forgiveness. We need care and comfort from those that are maturing next to us. Verse 47 says that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. It's a beautiful verse, the testimony of our resurrected Savior. It's a charge to us to respond in his name. Those who believe the story of God's news say, I know I'm a sinner, separated from God, can do nothing to earn his favor. I believe in Jesus, God's Son, that he died for my sins, that he rose again from the dead. I'm sorry for my sinful thoughts and my actions. I turn from them and trust in Jesus alone for forgiveness. I want to live for Jesus, be a new person, to learn to love others, and I'll live forever with God in the joy of his new creation. Jesus delivers from sin those he loves. The last two verses here, Jesus directs the lives of those that he loves. You are witnesses of these things. Now that they've seen him, the disciples enjoy a freedom from being startled and frightened. They have been let free from their disbelief, now fully marveling in their risen Savior. Go tell the good news is the witness's responsibility. Verse 49, behold, I'm sending the promise of the Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Christ makes an acclamation here. Christ will soon send and has now sent the Holy Spirit to indwell every believer. These disciples would never have been able to fulfill the given task. We would never have been able to fulfill the given task until Christ himself had ascended into heaven, leaving us with his Holy Spirit, this divine strength to equip us for the calling of witnessing his death and resurrection. In whom do you place your trust for eternal life, dear friend? For it is only by repentance for the forgiveness of sins we will see him in paradise. And until that day comes, may we finish the race well, sharing the good news until we hear one day, well done, good and faithful servant. Christ suffered and rose on the third day from the dead so the gospel could be proclaimed. This means that no matter the trials we face in this world, we should preach the good news of repentance for the forgiveness of sins in his name to all the nations. Close with me in prayer this morning. Thou blessed Spirit, author of all grace and comfort, come work repentance in my soul. Melt my heart by the majesty and the mercy of God. Teach me to behold my Creator. May I confide in his love and his power. Make me willing to be saved in his way, perceiving nothing in myself but all in Jesus. Help me not only to receive him, but to walk in him, depend on him, commune with him, be conformed to him, follow him, imperfect but still pressing forward, not complaining of labor, but valuing rest, not murmuring under trials, but thankful for my state. God, give me grace and faith which is the means of salvation. Perceiving nothing in myself, may I find in Christ wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to close singing the first two verses, Jesus, Your Mercy.
Seated for just a moment. This morning, we are so pleased to welcome some folks in the membership here at East White Oak Bible Church. I'd like to ask you to come forward right now, Dan Brown, Peter McClure, Jerry Hahn, Jacob and Shannon Blackwood. If you'd please come up and join me right here in the front now. Some pictures of a few of the folks here. Each of them have professed faith in Christ Jesus, have been through our membership class. These classes are really important. These classes help us understand who God is. It helps us understand how the church is to serve well in its community and for its congregation. And today we have the joy of welcoming these folks into membership. I do need to identify we have a quorum present, so if you're a voting member at East White Oak, would you hold your hand up? Absolutely, we have a quorum. Praise the Lord. If you're ready to receive these folks, these dear ones into the membership here at East White Oak, you're going to affirm by saying, yes, we do. Congregation?
Yes, we do.
Amen and amen. After I dismiss in just a minute, I'll invite you up front to greet these folks, make your way, and welcome them. We're so blessed to be able to have this happen today. We're so thankful for each one that you would join our body here at East White Oak Bible Church. We'll have two classes coming up. If you're interested in membership, please come and ask me, ask any of our pastors, our elders, our teachers here. Saturday, July 27th, typically the last Saturday in July. It's an all-Saturday class. It's a marathon. Okay, a couple of our folks have been through the marathon. So Saturday, July 27th, if you're interested in our class upcoming. And then we'll offer it again in the fall after Labor Day. Six Sundays in a row, there'll be a class here on Sunday morning that you can attend before your time of worship. Please stand with me this morning, congregation, and be dismissed. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Have a wonderful Lord's Day.